Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacrament. Confess, O Almighty God,
and to my brothers and sisters, that I have prayed to sin in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all the angels and the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, who pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Against them. sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who debt to us. And do not subject us to the final test. And he said to them, suppose one has a friend, whom he goes at midnight and says, friend, bring me 3 loaves of bread from a friend of mine who has just arrived at the house from a journey.
Visits anywhere I go, and I had the chance early on to get to St. Mary's on Saturday evening, but I've been longing to get here. I confess, I waited until the summer. I know that. I'm not sure. But you see, this parish means something very important to me. I kind of feel like I belong, like I'm an old parishioner here. You see, way back 1968, I was 6 years old, and growing up, at that point, my family was living in the Bronx. We moved later that year out to Long Island. But that summer, we spent in a bungalow here in Rockaway on 51st Street, and in what's now just this big empty lot. I live there now. But St. Gertrude's is the parish where we worshiped that summer. So, you know, I might have to put an envelope in the basket. I don't know. But I really do want to get here to be with you, and not certainly for those sentimental reasons, but I wanted also to be together with you. You were sitting here, you were joined together in prayer. I want to be able to share life, pray with you, celebrate this Holy Eucharist. What great blessings God gives to us, and in a special way, we celebrate those blessings today. You know, speaking of my youth, my time in youth, I also remember going to school and learning the catechism. Remember the old Baltimore catechism? I was sort of in those transitional days. But you remember the first question? Who made God? Second question. Why did God make me? God made me to know him, love him, serve him in this life, and to be happy with him forever. You got it. Here's something a little radical. What would you say if I told you that the inverse is also true? We don't think about that too often. We know what our duty is. But did you ever think that God made us, God made me, because God wanted to know me and love me? And yes, even to serve me in this life and to be happy with me. God didn't need me to be happy, but God wanted to create me. God wanted to create you. God wanted to create you as you are for that eternity of happiness. And God created you because God wanted to know you, really know you, and love you. Yeah, it might sound blasphemous, but if you stop and think about it, God
God wanted to serve? Well, my goodness, everything I have, everything I am is really a gift from God, right? It's through God's providential hands. God came among us, knelt to lift up those who struggle. He knelt to wash the feet of his apostles. He gave himself on the cross of love for us. So as radical as it sounds, pretty logical to say, yes, God made me, God made you, because he wanted to know us, love us, and serve us in this life. He wanted to be part of our lives here. And he wanted us to be eternal. He wanted us to be with him forever. You see, that in a sense is what Jesus is getting at in the gospel today when he talks about prayer. It's not praying because he has a heavy obligation that you have to go, okay, time to go out to prayer, so I have to do this, 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 and this, because otherwise God's not going to be happy. No. Jesus is talking about prayer because Jesus is inviting us into the heart of his Father. And so when he's there at prayer and his disciples say, Jesus, teach us how to pray, what does he give them? He gives them the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father, something so very important. I say this, you know, I love that prayer. I always say, the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father, contains the words, my first encounter with sacred scripture. Think about it. The first words that most of us learn of the Bible, before we could even read a letter, we learned the Our Father. So that's our first experience of Scripture. When I was ordained a bishop 10 years ago, the motto I chose was, I will be done from that prayer. They say it was written on my grandfather's tombstone. So the first written words of Scripture. And I'll tell you a little hint, when I hear confessions, that's always a penance. 1 hour bottom. I say it's got everything in it. It's got the whole kit and caboodle, everything. The whole gospel is right there in the hour bottom. And let's face it, it's a prayer Jesus himself gave us, right? So this one holds an important place. Now today in Luke's gospel, we heard the shorter version, okay? We heard a little bit, just slightly different from what we're used to saying, and a little bit shorter. But let me go through the prayer that's familiar with us. And I'm just going to take it in two parts. There are 7 petitions, 5 in the Luke's gospel. 7 petitions. The first 3 really have to do with God, our relationship with God. Right? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done. All right? Let's now stop there for a second and think about this. What do we say? What we're saying is that we want to be part of God's kingdom, thy kingdom come. God doesn't need me to make his kingdom come. God doesn't need me to make his name holy. And God's will is going to be done whether I want it or not. What are we saying when we pray? What we're saying is that we, you and I, want to live as members of his kingdom. Not as members of the kingdom of Satan. Not as members of the kingdom of the world. Oh yes, friends, we live in the midst of the world. That's our calling, to live in the world. But we live in the midst of the world as citizens of heaven, God's kingdom. We choose. We're saying we choose to live as members of God's own household. Now, sometimes I know when I do confession, when I sit and pray, my attitude sometimes is, my will be done, not thy will be done. But the fact is, when we humble ourselves and pray the Lord's Prayer, pray it earnestly, we say, Lord God, I believe in you and I trust you so much that no matter what's going on, I place myself in your hands. I want to I want to be part of your heart. Even if sometimes I get a little frustrated along the way, I want to be part of your family. I'm praying that our desires may conform more to Christ. And then, of course, there are the prayers of this world, what we need to do along the way, because we also recognize while we are living as citizens of heaven in the midst of this world, we need to help along the way, right? So give us this day our forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Ouch. Lead us not into and in other words, when I'm walking through this world, God, I need your help. I need all the help I can get. Even that daily bread. I always say when I was a kid, another part of my youth, when I was a little bit older, I delivered papers. Newsday was an afternoon paper of these to deliver. I delivered it, my sisters delivered it, my brother. We had three routes. Three of us had routes, okay? You know what that really meant? That meant my mother had three routes. Because she had to put all the stuff together, and we came home from school, and everything was neatly sorted, and sometimes we needed a little bit of encouragement, you might say, to get out and do the work. Even the things I earned, come from God's promise. Even my ability to earn, come from God's promise. I need God's help. And so that's where this prayer comes in so important. Because on the one hand, we're turning ourselves, saying, I really do want to be part of this household, part of your family, oh God. And yeah, while I'm on this earth, I need your help along the way. What we recognize when we pray is that, yes, God made me to know him, to love him, and to serve him in this life, and to be happy with him forever in the end. And God made me because God wanted to know me, love me, serve me in this world. Me along the way. Here's a blessing, right? Doesn't mean that we always get our way, does it? Wouldn't it be nice, right? Jesus didn't run us an easy life. But what it does mean is that we're never ever alone. I love this, you know, like in the gospel today, Jesus says, what father would give his son a snake when he asks for a fish, or a scorpion when he asks for an egg? So then, what happens when the kid asks for a scorpion or a snake? In other words, not everything I want is really the best thing. But even the goods that I see, in the end, I know that it's God's will that will be better for me. So in the end, humbly, all together, we pray, thy will be done. And God's thy will. For my will be open. So keep in mind today on this beautiful summer day, God made us. God made us in love. God made us to know who loved him and served him, but God made us to know what to serve us. He made us to be happy together.
Yeah.
chose children of God, we bring our needs before our Father in heaven.
For the church, that we may imitate God's generosity, as we receive all those that we need, spiritually and spiritually. Have us pray.
Gertrude, spread throughout the world,
words to me, may he always be in that same long stress and great blessed moment. Come in our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you. 703, lift on the cross, number 703.